Okay, you mentioned I might be able to share my my screen.
Yeah, please do.
Do you know how?
Okay, so if you go to, or maybe you should call me, or so if you go to
share screens.
Yeah, do you have a share screen option? Okay, now we can see it. Yeah.
Okay. So, all right, I'm going to introduce myself just very quickly. This is a talk that I've done a couple of times, once to Java Zone and also in Oslo and also in the Dublin that I did yesterday. Just flip back. So who am I? My name is Peter Lawrey. I'm a Java champion. I have the most answers for Java and JVM on Stack Overflow. And I'm also a founder of the Performance Java Users Group and lead architect of Chronicle Software. Who is Chronicle Software? Chronicle Software is a company that was formed a couple of years ago, 2.5 years ago, to help companies move to high performance Java code. And in fact, most of our clients are in C++ and C# shops. And we have a number of open source projects which you can read. A lot of people have said that they find it interesting to read our code, and they learn a lot from that, even if they don't use the code much themselves. Although quite a lot of banks do use our products. So this is what the stack looks like. The green products are all open source, and you can see them. So I'm going to talk very briefly about core and bytes and wire. And these are some of the underlying libraries which you may find interesting. They allow you to get low-level access to JVM. That's what core does. Bytes allows you to have thread-safe access to off-heap memory, which has the nice property that you can build data structures and memory map files and have those files shared between processes. And in fact, we have two products that do that, which is Q and Map. So you can look at how they're done in terms of using memory map files to share data between process JVMs. We also have a module called Chronicle Wire, and that supports different wire formats. You have a single API, you say what data you want to read or write, and then it works out. You tell it which format, and it will write out in YAML or JSON or some binary formats for efficiency. So you can read and write JSON efficiently that way. And last but not least, we've got a product called Engine, which allows you to remotely access data structures that are distributed. And you can set up things such as live queries and also distributed Lambda operations. So any questions about that? That's quite a lot to cover in just a few minutes.
No questions so far, Peter.
No questions so far. Okay, so I'm just going to jump into a little discussion about what is low latency. Low latency often means that you care about latency and you have an idea of how much the latency of an operation costs your business. But in low latency, what I tend to assume is that we care about latencies you can't see. So usually with web applications, if the latencies are too short for a human to see, that's fast enough. However, particularly in training applications, you actually care about latencies which are between 10 and 100 times too fast for a human to see. So you're dealing at very short timescales. And the only way to measure, to be able to get a feel for that is to have a program measure itself, because otherwise there's no way to know what your latencies are. You can't see it visually. Another thing about latencies rather than throughput is that measuring latencies is important for getting consistent service to clients, so consistent service to terms of trading, but also consistent service in terms of clients, because clients tend to remember the worst service they ever got. They also tend to, if you get a delay, you get a knock-on effect. So it's like a traffic jam. If someone stops really suddenly, stops in the middle of the road, that causes all the cars behind it to slow down and stop as well. So you get a very similar effect with requests. If one of them stops, you can have a disastrous knock-on effect, and it can take the system quite a long time before it's running smoothly again. I also talk about ultra-low GC, and what I mean by ultra-low GC is that the garbage rates are so low that you can run for an entire day without triggering a single garbage collection. That's even no minor collections. That may seem a bit extreme, but in fact, you can achieve this if you keep to within 1 to 2 gigabytes of garbage an hour. And if you do that, then you can actually create an even space, which is larger than all the garbage you produce in a day. And that will allow you to run all day without a collection. So that brings me on to a related topic, which is compressed loops. What does this mean? Well, what you can do in a 32-bit application is that you have 32-bit references. Now, if you have a 64-bit C application, for example, you'll have 64-bit pointers, which uses twice as much memory, and Java uses a lot more pointers than other languages, which allow embedded value types. So what JVM can do, though, is it can use 32-bit references to address more memory than you would otherwise think. So if it's less than 4 gigabytes on the left-hand side, you can address 4 gigabytes of memory comfortably with a 32-bit reference. But in reality, all objects have to be on an 8-byte boundary, which means the address of the objects, the lower 3 bits of the address, are always 0. So you don't need to store them. And Intel has an efficient operation for multiplying by 8. So in fact, instead of limiting to 32 gigabytes, you can have, 4 gigabytes, you can have 4 billion times 8 bytes, because they're 8-byte boundaries, or 8-byte multiples. And that allows you to get 32 gigabytes of addressable space with 32-bit references. So it actually means that most JVMs are actually running, even if they're 64-bit, are actually using 32-bit references, as long as the heap size is under 32 gigabytes. And in fact, in Java 8, you have the option to go to 64 gigabytes with compressed tools. So, reiterating what I mentioned earlier, if you create up to 2 gigabytes of garbage an hour, you can actually run all day on a 48 gigabyte heap without a collection. And this translates to about 0.5 megabyte a second garbage. That just said, okay, so if you don't have any GC pauses, does that mean you have no pauses? Well, actually, this is not the case. You get pauses in your operating system due to interrupts, and you can get interrupts of between 5 and 50 milliseconds. And this is an interrupt that's not visible to the JVM. It won't report that it was delayed by this amount of time. And it won't show up in any profiler. It's just, unfortunately, something the operating system will do. You can tune the operating system so it doesn't do this, but that requires a bit of work. But you're more likely to see network delays, database delays. So these still kick in, even if you don't have GC pauses. So how does Java 8 help? In particular, Java 8 has two ways of reducing the amount of garbage produced. By reducing the amount of garbage produced, we get less GC pauses, or we can run for longer without GCs, and the applications can run more efficiently. Also, when you create less garbage, that's less work you have to do. So it's not only the work of cleaning it up, but there's work of creating it in the first place. So in Java 8, it has the concept of a non-capturing lambda. So what a non-capturing lambda means is that it doesn't capture any variables. It's just a piece of code. There's no variables that it gets from its context. And a non-capturing lambdas are cached, so that you don't create a new object each time you use them. Also, Java 8 has scape analysis that is quite efficient. In Java 6 and 7, you had escape analysis, but it didn't do very much. But in Java 8, you can actually have objects placed on the stack. So short-lived objects, if they don't escape a method, can be placed on the stack and therefore don't create garbage either. So here's some examples of some lambdas. We've got three lambdas here. The first one is non-capturing. The second one is actually capturing, and that's because it takes system.out as an argument, whereas in the first example, system.out is part of the code, and in the last example, it's non-capturing. So what this means is that each time you call these methods, in the first and last case, you get the same object because it's cached, but in the middle one, you get a different object each time because it creates a new one. So you can actually see this in this example. If you call hello world twice, it actually returns the same object, and in the last case it returns the same object, but in the middle case it returns a different object, which is why when you compare them, it prints false. One of the consequences of this is if you had a set of the first two, right, you would have a set of one. If you set of the last two, you'd also have a set of one. But if you have the set of the middle two, you have a set of two, because it creates two objects, and it won't see them as duplicates. There's also a topic of serialization. So I'm skimming through this quite a bit. So if you have a search for low latency lambdas on JavaZone, because I did this talk for JavaZone, you'll see the full version, but this will hopefully whet your appetite. So I also talk about serialization, and the reason you might want to serialize lambdas is that you want to have distributed code. So in this example, which is taken from our Redis emulation class, you can see in the middle that there's two lambdas here. The point of this, though, is that these lambdas are being called from a client application, so it's a client connecting to a server, but it wants to run those lambdas on the server. So it packages these lambdas up, serializes.